money come in from dues and so forth, so that currently we have just a little bit over $17,000 in the free checking accounts. Let's see if there's anything else. Now, I had a call from the lady from the Sudbury Historical Society. I don't know if any of you folks go to any of their affairs, but she wanted me to be sure to tell you that their meeting of January 7th has been canceled. Wherever they were going to meet was taken over by the library. I think the library over there is being dedicated that day, or something is taking place. So she wanted me to be sure that you don't come to their affair on January 7th. Nobody will be there. Lou had something to say about something happening over in Stowe.
This thing is very tricky.
Hi, I'm Lou Halperin.
I didn't want to come.
Get away from this. I want to invite you all to my birthday party. Back when I was 60, I won't tell you how many years ago that was, decided to have a party to celebrate the event. And rather than have a party given for me, I decided to make the party and invite everybody to come. Got the town hall over at Stowe and worked with the Stowe Historical Society because this was a historic event. We set up a nice party. I got the best band that I couldn't afford, the Black Eagles, to...
one of those things where you sit for 3 hours looking at somebody's vacation slides. There are very few slides, but all the more important ones show up on the wall. So I'm going to ask Herbie Tauber, you all know Herbie, to come up and start talking about aviation and Summer Street and whatever else he wishes to do.
Well, there are a number of issues we're flying out of this farm, and we have some pilots among us. But Roy Mason, with he's been flying ultralights for how many years, Roy?
20 years.
And where's Fred? Oh, right there. There's another pilot. And next to him is Bruce McGilroy, who's a retired Delta Airlines pilot. And there's somebody else here. Who else?
I'm here.
One of us. Oh, that, no, you never flew. Huh? Yeah, and Vic. He's my partner in several airplanes. Yeah, he was pretty bad, but you know, we got along together. Why don't you start those slides and we'll start from there.
Want the lights?
That'd be a good idea, wouldn't it? Well, I'm in the way. That's a picture of Alaska. Because of the position you see, that's on takeoff. That's not landing. That was Sid leaving with the Luscombe out of Maine and up at the Mason farm. The next one. And that's me and the old Baraka champ leaving the other way. Not at the same time, of course. There's another one of Luscombe. That's landing because you're on the further end. And there's another one. Next one. Oh. That's a standard Sid Mason takeoff. It goes like a son of a gun down low and pulls up steeply. Very spectacular. And right here, does anybody recognize this? Do anybody know where we are? You don't, huh? That's the Assabit River. And that's Lake Boone. And the dam's right there. And there's the bridge that goes to the landing. You know? That's not Russell's Bridge. This is way up at the, you know.
That's Sudbury Road, right?
Yeah. Is that Sudbury Road up in that? Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. That was...
That's the orchard?
That's an orchard up there that...
It's Honeypot Farm.
Yeah. Yeah, Honeypot Farm.
Come on.
Try the next one. Oh, keep going. That's me when Forrest Nelson said, turn around, Herb. And I looked around and took my picture. It happened several times.
But he meant he wanted to go home, turn around.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, he said he was there. He said he was there. Now, Now, you all recognize the clock tower, and that is the Fowler School. This is Summer Street. There's an orchard up there that was where the...
Come on, Tom.
And probably Brook Street and all those others up here in this part of the village. Try again, Paul, let me get something. Oh, this is Palmer Road. And that used to be Tenuzzo, Ray Tenuzzo down here on Palmer Road. And right here was, you know, Victory Market and Donald's, that just moved out in this area here. That, does anybody know what that is? Back in the old days, they used to raise minks on the mink farm up there off of Concord Street.
That was Taylor's.
Yeah, Taylor. I think the name, Taylor was the name?
Right.
Yeah. A lot of people must remember that.
The smell was...
Especially the people that live near it, they could smell it. And...
Summer Hill.
No, it isn't. Do you recognize that little circle right there?
Green Meadow School.
Green Meadow School, and there's the street that goes down beside the mill.
Thompson
Street. Great Road goes along here. And your Great Road Dodge was across the street there somewhere.
And over to the right would have been the high school.
Yeah, over to the right would be the high school, would be over here. The new school is going in here.
So where was this taken from?
Oh, this was probably over the ammunition dump. Yeah, over to it that way.
What year?
Oh, God, that was...
Before Dodge Dealing built...
Yeah, before Great Road Dodge built their facility across the street from where they were.
That's in the
mid-50s. Mid-50s, yeah. Probably 58, maybe. And that's me. I'm attempting to land in a 85 horse Maronka Champion at the farm.
Now, was that your favorite airplane?
That was my favorite airplane.
Right.
That was of all the aircraft, that was the nicest to fly, the most comfortable. And it had a little bit of heat, so it wasn't too bad in the winter. Now, that's on skis, you notice. We flew a lot off of skis. Now, that's looking down on the farm from the main inside. This is the aircraft were kept here.
I heard you show me where it's Paddy Lane, Michael Road.
We're looking for it's stalled
here. Yeah. There's roads that go down through here and here, and that's the end of Sid Mason Strip is right in here. Right there. And when I was a little kid and they would fly those old aircraft, I used to, about 5 or 6 years old, I'd sit behind that big rock right there, and the aircraft would go over my head.
So where's Summer Street?
Summer Street, you can't see it. Summer Street is over here. Try again. Maybe we can find something else they don't know. Well, after we took that picture of the farm, the gas tank was getting a little low, so we needed fuel. And so we went to Marlboro Airport, which this is Marlboro Airport right here. The hangars are right there. And we were still on skis. We were flying on skis in those years. Try again, Paul. So we landed to get gas, and with a little bit of snow. But that was no problem. We were young and foolish, you know? And this is my favorite shot. That's Great Road going out here, Main Street to the mill. What else?
The dam, the bus barn there.
Oh yeah.
The church there.
Come on. Yeah, this, you know, the bus barn is here and the church is here. And there's the Assabet River going down there. Is that true that that was called, what, the Elizabeth River in the old days, before they changed it?
Yeah, Elizabeth, Elizabeth.
Yeah. And is it true that some old duffer didn't like it to be changed to the Assabet River because they said that they might as well name Summer Hill Girdle Hill? Yeah, because it was above the Assabet. I lost my place. So that's a mill. And
I've never seen the citizen.
Yeah, well, you know, I've got an excuse. I can't remember my own name. Good. Isn't that, oh, I know where this is. That used to be Russo's Restaurant. This is Waltham Street. Going down to the light at the corner. Now, that's Powder Mill Road, right? That's Summer Street, and there's the field that we flew out of. And there's the Mason Farm right there. And the hill, you notice, is there's no houses on the hill. And Main Street, naturally, that way.
You see Pilot Grove Farm Hill in the background.
Yeah, that's Pilot Grove, way back here.
You see the Boston Harbor from
the early days. What was the story on that, Bruce? They were supposed to see, what was the story on that?
The pines on top of the hill.
You could see the pines on top of the hill?
Pilot Grove.
And they would say?
Boston Harbor.
Out of Boston Harbor. I find that kind of difficult to believe, you know.
Well, from this height, you could see.
Yeah, but from here. I was saying that, how could you see the pines on top of that hill from Boston Harbor?
Well, supposedly from Boston Harbor, they had just the telescopes, and they zeroed in on the Pilot Grove pines. And that's how far in the Boston Harbor.
Oh.
Old grove of trees up there.
There was, I remember. They were quite tall.
All went down the hurricane, except about three.
Yeah, the hurricane, there was only about three left. You better move on before I forget what I'm doing. Now, this is Dick Corson and Forrest Nelson Sr. used to own this airplane. And the only reason I put it, this is a J-5 Cub. It was supposed to be a three-seater. It had 65 horsepower. We flew it quite a bit. It was a nice aircraft.
Did it have 65 as well?
65, definitely, yeah. We flew it quite a bit. It came into the farm quite a bit, you know, for sure enough. And the next picture is taken from this aircraft. Now, do you recognize that? Nason Street, Summer Street, Main Street, the fire station.
Looks like the park is still there.
Yeah, and the park is still there. Yeah.
And the railroad tracks are still there.
And the railroad tracks are still there. That was a pretty good shot. Oh, I'd have to look on the back of it. I think it was 60, 59, 60, 61.
The tracks are still there.
Yeah, the tracks were still there. Of course, they weren't being used, but I think that I'm looking down the tracks, and there's the United Co-op where Dunn Oil is now. That building is still there. And these are the old buildings. The track used to go in here, and they used to bring the coal cars and the grain cars and the United Cooperative Society. And Sam Savella and his friend built this building. This is Sam Savella's body shop. Right, Sam?
Yeah.
Yeah, looks familiar? You never saw the roof.
Yeah, quite a while.
Yeah, but you've never seen it from that position, have you? Oh, what did I do now? All right, this is taken from the ammunition dump. You can see the fence area and the ammunition dump. Right here, you're looking down at the pond. What are those streets off of Great Road that, you know, they're...
Driscoll.
Yeah, those streets. Yeah, O'Moore and all those, that's right there. And there's no houses. Now, this is Alumni Field.
Yeah,
no digital. No, yeah, there's that, that's... The field house is right there. They were having a football game. There's a cemetery. And there aren't, there are a few houses, there's all a bunch of new houses in here. Ronnie Dawson lived in this house down here. Which one? This one or this one? I don't remember. One or the other. Yeah. Yeah. Well, this is, we wandered away once in a while, and that you can see we're heading up toward, that's Hanscom Field right here. Back in those days. This is that 85 horse champ that I, wait a minute. No, that's a, yeah, that's 85 horse. That's a Fairchild 24. Yeah, it's got the strut going down to the sink. And the other strut going up to the Fairchild 24. That was a radio, 165 horse radial engine, four place. Nice airplane.
Is that the plane that went to gas?
Yeah, well, it's doing 10 gallons of gas, landing, taking off, or cruising. 10 gallons an hour. Next. And we decided to wander off. Does anybody recognize that? Huh? And look familiar to anybody? Venture a guess.
Cape Cod.
Chatham. Take me in.
How about Gloucester Harbor? Yeah, Gloucester Harbor. Take the next one with a real close-up. I don't know if that'll be any better. That's Gloucester Harbor.
How'd you find your way back?
We followed roads.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. We had no radio. We had a compass. We knew the ocean was, you know, in the wrong direction. If we kept going, we wouldn't, you know, get home. The next one is around the dry salvagers and little salvagers down there off of Rockport. We're going right around the edge of it, you know. Beautiful day. Oh, here we are at Wright Patterson. Yeah. And there's Forrest Nelson Sr. standing in front of the B-24. That all this stuff was outside. It's all inside now. We were wandering around in those days. Go try again. B-36. Forrest standing in front of it. That thing, it looked terrible. If you ever see that inside that new facility they got, it shines.
Is this Bedford?
No, this is Minuteman. This is Forrest Nelson and I own this 65 horse champ for a while. And things went along and we bought something else. This is that's my airplane now. That's the one that when Vic O'Scarker learned to fly, and I said, well, come on, Vic, you join me and we in my airplane. We were flying this thing for a while. It's Cessna 150, very nice airplane. Still around. Huh? 1969.
That was fire.
Yeah. Yeah, they went down. You went through
the whole
thing. He had it for. Yeah, Roy had it for a while. He learned how to fly too.
You bought that at
That's a Fairchild 24. Bob Mason and I own that, one like that. That's up in Jaffrey, New Hampshire, at fly-in. Whoop, there's another one out of another aircraft we own. That was Forrest told me to turn around again, and there it is. So what are you talking about? There's Forrest Jr. and Forrest Sr. Forrest Jr. is a Delta Airlines captain. He flies overseas. And we have several, you know, distinctive people. Dick Causland was from Maynard. He was a captain for Delta. And he started with Northeast and moved into Delta when they were bought out. And young Forrest Nelson started with the lower airlines in Hawaii. And he came to Northeast Airlines and flew for them a while. Then Delta took it over. Now, quite a thing. And we've got one fellow did very well with Delta. Leo Mullen, he's the head man at Delta Airlines. Yeah. A graduate of Maynard High School.
It should be noted that Little Flory is now a 777 Boeing captain.
Yeah, a big, how many thousand pounds does that take off?
I can't count that high.
No, you can't?
Yeah.
I knew you'd say that. We had a waitress in at the restaurant, and we'd call in 2213 Delta on our down, you know, on Fineland downwind, we'd always call in. And this woman would be always calling it 13 dog. I wouldn't mention any names, Betsy. But this is the airplane we brought out of that blue and white champ. And we flew this for quite a while. This was a good airplane. It was a 170B. That is. We took a ride up to Keene, New Hampshire to get a cup of coffee, you know, $100 cup of coffee. And that is Mount Monadnock on the way back in the wintertime. Well, it happens that we wandered a little bit further. Here we are leaving for Florida with Don McPherson's airplane. Once again. There we are. There's Sydney and myself standing down at Baybridge, Maryland at the airport. We went in for lunch. And there's the airplane behind us that we flew in. And there we are, we're departing Baybridge, Maryland. That's down Annapolis in that area, you know. Beautiful, beautiful shot. Here we are on the way home. Mother's waiting for me to take me home. And Sid's standing there. Go to the next one. There's another one, Sid got all his baggage. Somebody taking a camera, got a shadow on the picture, I wonder who that was. And we put the airplane away. Next. Whoop, how did we end up at the gas station? That's the United Corp gas station back when I was working there in 46 or something like that. I got thrown in there somewhere. You know where that, everybody knows where that is. That's at Store 24 now.
Yeah.
Now that's an airplane that was a dust of sprayer aircraft down in Hanscom Field. And with all the pieces down there, we went down and belonged to Nate Mayo and Jerry Mears. They went down and bought it. It was an old piece. We loaded up in a truck with Roy's father. He borrowed one of Fletcher's trucks, and we went down and we picked it up and took it up to Hudson, where they, that's what, it be, what became of it. Yeah, it's a beautiful aircraft. And we wandered off from time to time down to out there, Oshkosh, Wisconsin. It was a very hot day that day, and everybody was in the shade of the wing of the B-17. Maybe a lot of you veterans will remember these aircraft. That's why I put them in there, because they are old aircraft. Yeah. They have a historic value. That's the B-1 bomber. Yeah. And that was back in 88. And there is the largest aircraft in the world, an Antonov. It's an AH-124. It is the largest aircraft in the world. That's bigger than the, what's it, what's the best? C-5A, yeah, it's bigger than C-5A. Wally Coffey and I went out one. That's a change. That's a World War I trainer that we used in this country, and the English imported them, and they trained their people with them, and the Canadians trained their people. It was such a reliable aircraft. And there's the engine, all the rock rounds are, you got all the oil can, and all the rock rounds before you were pulled. So you got spattered with oil in that engine. Has anybody ever had a chance to fly in one? I haven't. No, I guess not, huh? Before your time? And the Australian showed up, 300 of them, in a 747 out of Australia. They always came in, you can see the kangaroo on the tail.
Yeah.
And then the SR-71, Blackbird, showed up. It was supposed to be its final flight. It wasn't, but it was supposed to be. They were going to put it in a museum after that. He came out of California in about 22 minutes. He wasn't in a hurry. Oh, and that's a parachute jump. They did that, a flight jump. They jumped at the beginning of the show. A bunch of jumpers would jump out and the airplanes would circle, and I caught that in the last section of it.
Where is this?
This is Oshkosh, Wisconsin, the largest fly-in in the world. There's usually 10,000 aircraft on the ground at all times. The busiest aircraft in the world, busiest airport in the world for 1 week. Looks like the Goodyear blimp showed up again. Grumman Avenger, largest single-engine airplane of World War II. How much horsepower did that have? Do you remember, Bruce?
I would be guessing, but probably in the order of 1,200.
The 1,200, yeah. Torpedo, and they had quite a crew. Oh, and the English showed up with the Concorde. That showed up. It showed up several years in a row. They took a flight. They sold tickets for a flight up over Canada. They went supersonic. This is on the return trip. Oh, Japanese Cape torpedo bomber of Pearl Harbor fame. Vought Corsair. Big airplane. There it is, Bruce. P-40 of...
It's owned by the Kalamazoo Air Museum right now. It was owned by Sue Parrish of Kalamazoo. She is one of the Upjohns.
Yeah, Upjohn Pharmaceuticals.
Yes,
yeah.
Very, very involved in aviation. Any airplane you see that's been Sue Parrish on it.
Yeah. I was there when she stepped out of that airplane. She had a little problem with that airplane, too, didn't she? She did ground loop, that she never flew it again.
Something happened
to her, and she figured that she couldn't handle it anymore, and she quit. put it in there. That is not an airplane. That is a Spitfire with a the two-seater Spitfire. Must have been training. It's the only one I've ever seen like that. P-47. There aren't too many of those around. Of all they're built, there aren't too many flying. That is a Russian Yak. Sitting by itself out there. Oh, Goodyear went by closer, but took another shot.
Good
climb. Yeah. It's going straight up. That's what it looks like, doesn't it? Going straight up. He was doing aerobatics for the show. And there weren't too many people there. I think there was only about 10 or 15,000 that day, as you can see. There's the Concorde. They just finished unloading it, and you can see the power carts and all the stuff around it. Keep the air conditioning running, I think, because it was a hot day. Well, now, that's not my realm right there. This fellow, what is that, Joe?
That's a Cold Flyer.
Uh-huh.
It's made by Homer Cold, which was out in Ohio. He was actually a farmer, and he got interested in aviation. He built this ultralight, which is, well, we have another picture. Okay.
Tell me about your ultralight.
And this is a gyrocopter. Now, the first gyrocopter was made by Benson, and Benson, he was using drone engines left over from World War II, which was an Avicraft engine, and it was a two-cylinder engine built like the regular Avicraft airplane, and it was two-cycle. It didn't have an exhaust, so the first one was a Benson, and no exhaust, quite loud, and this is pushed through the air from an engine behind, like in back of the seat. You see this female showing. There's a push prop back there, and it pushes the airplane forward. And you might believe the top blade is a wing. You know, when it gets spinning, it's a round wing. It does the same thing as a fixed wing does. It has a big large circle with a high and low pressure. But to make a gyrocopter, the air goes up through where a helicopter is blasting the air down through. And even people know how to fly, stand there and say the air goes up through the blade and it flies. But when the blade is spinning, you can imagine it's everywhere. It creates a solid round disc above you, which is a high and a low pressure, which is a wing. And when you push it through the sky about 40 miles an hour, it generates lift.
That's all the other ones I've got.
Okay. Oh, Herbie's back.
Back again. Here we go again, Minuteman Field. How did that one get in there? Oh, all right. I don't remember when that was. Later, move on again. Oh,
hey, that's
my
point.
That's
you didn't have it yet.
I had that at the time.
I sold that to a guy in Norwood, and I forgot to put the oil cap back on when I delivered. It was oil dripping off. I've done it twice in my life. I did it in 182, too. We went to takeoff.
Oh, yeah?
And we got halfway down the runway. It was takeoff time. We were headed for Moosehead Lake Flying. And we just broke ground. And the oil cap was on my brother's side, which was piloting command that day. And he couldn't see. I had to take over and fly it as the co-pilot and bring it back around and in. And the question was, well, who checked the oil? It was scary.
That Summer Street guy is supposed to be smart. Don't do like that.
We didn't crash.
There's the tail of it. That's the inside. Not too much instrumentation. Very easy to fly. I think if you could walk and chew gum, you could fly that thing.
Most airplanes, I think.
Yeah. It's on the trip. By the way, Paul took these photos. We were up there. This was Vehicle of the Month at one time.
Right.
At the car club.
Car club.
Yeah. Did you imagine? We have motorcycles and airplanes and everything else. Yeah.
Car of the Month.
Car of the Month, yeah. That's the Car of the Month.
Thanks, sir.
Can we run out?
Yes.
Thank God. That didn't last very long, did it?
No.
No, you're pretty long-winded.
Okay, wait a minute. We've got the Luskin story that I got to have. Roy's going to read about the Luskin.
We have the Luskin story. We'll get many, many pictures.
Yeah, there's a bunch of pictures over here.
Over there.
Herb has to tell a story about this one.
Which plane?
This plane, when they flew it. Well, what happened with the kerosene?
Oh, well, yeah, this is quite different. It's an Avro 504. I looked it up. Did you see that, Bruce? And the thing was that during the war, that they used castor oil and mixed it with the...
Which war?
Yeah. They mixed it with the gasoline for lubrication. And you know what castor oil, a good dose of castor oil, and it better be constipated when you leave.
So it was a healthy flight.
It was a healthy flight. But I don't know. The thing I can't figure out is, where did this Avro 504, it's an English aircraft, what was it doing? Why weren't we flying the Jenny instead of this? I thought the Jenny was a better airplane. Or maybe it wasn't. But this was the engine was, the crankshaft was bolted to the firewall. The engine and the propeller were one piece, they spun together.
One throttle setting.
Yeah, one throttle setting. It was very difficult.
How did you control the speed of the engine?
Yeah, they controlled the speed of the engine by shutting off the ignition. They had a flipper switch that would just go burp, 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 you know, and they tried to get it to, and it was pretty tricky taking off. They tell me you had to run it till it was lean and go a little bit rich, because if you got in the air, the mixture would change, and there was no way in the world you're going to be changing the mixture up there. But it's quite an interesting airplane. Down on Palmer Road back in the old days, that's back in Wally's days, he remembers. You did. Didn't you fly in that thing? Or maybe it was Paul Fossey that wrote it. I know it wasn't Fred Dodge, because he wouldn't admit to it even if he did.
Benny's got a question.
I have a question. That largest plane that you showed,
what
was that from?
That was a Russian aircraft, yes.
I saw that in Maastricht.
Yeah.
Years ago.
Yeah.
And right now it's in chains at the Maastricht Airport because they can't pay for the maintenance that they had on the plane and all the other expenses.
I wouldn't be a bit surprised.
Well, that trip they brought in to Oshkosh, they had stopped in Chicago to fuel it up and never paid for the fuel. Yeah. They still wanted dead or alive for fuel.
They wanted dead or alive for fuel. But I Oshkosh supplied them with the fuel for so they get back, didn't they?
Well, they wouldn't make it. They had to pull into Chicago. Well, maybe, you know, from there on, but they were already filled up.
Yeah.
They stopped in Chicago, and they tied them up for a day, and then they finally agreed to let them go. And as far as I know, they still wanted dead or alive for the fuel bill.
Oh. I think we ought to chip in.
No. Big bucks.
That was an impressive aircraft.
Yeah.
We walked through that fuel. It must have been as wide as this inside, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was as wide as this foot.
Well, they brought airplanes inside.
Yeah, they brought the aerobatic aircraft. Those,
yeah.
What was that aerobatic that they brought in then?
Well, these are aerobatics at the big one year. They're still in competition today.
Yeah. What the heck was that aircraft they flew in?
The star on it, yeah.
They flew them into Florida. Oh, God.
This deal is all over the country.
Yeah, the deal is all over the country for that thing. Aerobatic, they flew across.
It was the first batch they got in.
Sukhois, yeah. Sukhois, yeah.
Right.
Yeah. They were two places.
They
came both ways.
Originally it was one.
Yeah.
Maybe they wanted the two to train, but maybe they didn't.
And they were pretty well built because Russians didn't have aluminum.
Radio engine.
Yeah, radio engine. They didn't have aluminum.
They used a lot of titanium.
That's all they had. Titanium.
Plenty of
it. Lots of it. In fact, the titanium for that SR-71, that Blackbird, was bought through a third party to build it. It came from Russia. That's quite a story, too. Where did Roy go?
I'm right here. Oh. Why don't you say a little bit about Sid? Talk about how Sid started flying and all that kind of stuff.
Sid. Sue tells me, I thought he started flying in Marlboro, but Sue tells me he first started in Westboro, then he transferred to Marlboro because when he got out of the service, he learned to fly under the GI Bill. They supplied, you know, education for them, and he learned in Marlboro, and that's what happened to me. He said, come on, let's go flying, I got to go get some time, so I'd go with him, and we'd fly all over the place, and loops and spins and stuff, that's crazy stuff.
And why
but if I had a place, if I had to land someplace, I'd like to fly with Sid because he could get in there.
tell him about Sid's recent problem.
Oh, yeah, well, Sid, I don't really know the whole story. Sue, his wife is here, and she got hit by a truck. So I guess he got stopped down at the town hall and right out front here.
Carson Street in front of your town hall. And my traffic and stove stopped. And they tell us to look both ways. He got to the double orange line. And this truck came along from Main and Ford Stove. Just hit him. Said he didn't see him.
Didn't see him.
And threw him about 6 feet.
Yeah, he's down at Spalding Rehabilitation Center right now, and he's doing a little better, isn't he?
Yes, they're doing wonderfully.
Yeah, doing good job for him. Roy, now it's your turn.
Okay, well, I know much about flying as no one. The only experience I ever had in any of these planes that I saw in the picture was when we were down the Cape when I was a little kid that high. Hyannis Airport was offering rides for $5. And my father said, "You want to go?" And I said, "Sure." And he said to my mother, "You want to go?" My mother says, "No." And so we talked about it for a while, and my mother said, "Well, you two go. I'm going to buy a leg of lamb with my money." So we paid the $5 each and were up for about 10 minutes, and then Sunday she had a leg of lamb and wouldn't give any of it to us. Well, this is a historical first. This is the first time that the Maynard Historical Society is having some program that comes off the internet. This is a story off the internet called Our Luscombe Story. The guy that wrote this really has a lot of characters in here. I got so confused when I read it this morning. I'll try to keep it straight. In early 1946, Jerry Bilodeau and his associate Roger A. Labreck, that's Jerry and Roger, remember that, ordered a new Luscombe, a two-seater, from Roland Maher at Maher's Airport in Minot, Maine. All right, we got three people. We're only in the first paragraph. It was a polished silver, registration NC72025, a model 8A all-middle aircraft with a Continental 65 horsepower engine. Roger flew the plane recreationally, and Jerry began to take flying lessons at Maher's School of Aviation, Incorporated. When Jerry acquired his private pilot's license, he marketed use of the aircraft with his soft drink bottling business. He coined the phrase, free ride, and put it on the bottle caps on his various tonics. And the lucky winners who bought it found themselves flying over the falls in Lewiston and Auburn. His wife, Jean, loved to fly in the Luscombe, especially to Boston, to enjoy big city life. But then, in late 1947, during a family crisis, Jerry decided to fly the Luscombe for a free ride winner, somebody who had got one of the bottle caps. His mother had just died. She had never wanted him to fly anyway, like many mothers. And on that day in October, Jerry attempted to take off from his gravel runway off Washington Street in Auburn. And before getting safely aloft, the Luscombe flipped on its back in the brush at the end of the strip. And at that time, Jean, the wife, and all the other family members believed that the crash was a curse from Jerry's deceased mother, who stole the lift from under his wings. Fortunately, no one was seriously hurt, but strangely enough, the authorities and the press never found out that he was carrying passengers. Later, it was concluded that pilot error had caused the crash, and the aircraft was overweight, the air temperature was high, and the pilot was under family stress, all on the runway barely long enough for a normal takeoff. Jerry soon gave up flying and decided to market his bottling business and hotel in other ways. He believed his mother would have wanted it that way. So the Luscombe aircraft was severely damaged and the insurance company hauled it off. Jerry, however, kept the original propeller and the logbooks, which he stored away. It was later discovered that Jerry's signature on the bill of sale of what was left of the aircraft was forged by an unknown party. Well, then we jump to 1985.
His grandson, Jerry's grandson, Dan, is attending Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University in Daytona Beach to learn to fly, and he gets a degree from that place in aeronautical science. Jerry, meanwhile, had died, so that when the boy graduated, the grandfather had already died. He had never taken his grandfather flying, but a few years after Jerry's death, a younger son, Dan's brother Michael, found this old propeller and the logbooks and gave them to his brother Dan, who was quite pleased to receive them in their original condition. But he never really looked at them very carefully. Later in the 90s, in the early 90s, Dan met a friend, Stephen, and they began a flying business together called the Bethel Air Service in Bethel, Maine. And Dan put his grandfather's propeller up on the wall of the business office, and there it remained for many years. In 93, Dan became the pilot for the Sunday River Skiway, and Steve, his friend, became the mechanic there, and business went on as usual. And then a couple of years later, while waiting for a flight, Dan noticed that the Luscombe propeller up on the wall for all these years had an engraved serial number adjacent to the hub. And after digging out the logbooks and examining them, he found that the numbers on the propeller and in the logbooks matched exactly. So the excitement generated from this correlation prompted him to call the Federal Aviation Administration in Oklahoma City. And with the tail number, N72025, it was easy to find out the status of this airframe and who the present owner was. No one since the accident had ever questioned the whereabouts of the Luscombe. Everybody assumed the crash had been a total loss and that the plane was no longer in existence. Well, the home of the N72025 since the early 50s had been Sid Mason's airport in Maine. At the time of the crash, the insurance company sold the aircraft to Turner Aviation Company in Turner, Maine. Twitchell's was the name of the family there. It was one of Ron Twitchell's first salvage projects, and he successfully repaired and restored the Luscombe to FAA standards, flew it himself for about a year, and then he sold it to Don's Flying Service in Marlborough, Mass. Sidney Mason had been the proud owner for most of the Luscombe's life, and he was very surprised to hear from Dan that afternoon. Sid and his wife Susan were excited to talk to somebody who actually had information on the past of their aircraft. And during the telephone conversation, it was revealed that Sid would someday lay under a tombstone that was engraved N72025. Dan journeyed south to meet with Sid and to see a piece of his grandfather's past. And upon arrival, Dan was very well received, despite the fact that Sid had owned the aircraft so long, and he could not realize that a man named Jerry Bilodeau had once owned and crashed the little Luscombe. And after a brief inspection of the original logbooks, it was quite evident that Dan was who he said he was. And that day, Dan and Sid enjoyed an afternoon of hangar flying. And before leaving, they had come to an agreement. If Sid ever attempted to sell the Luscombe, he would give Dan first option to buy. In exchange for this, Dan would forward the original logbooks if for any reason he could not buy the aircraft. And so after a brief ride in the Luscombe, Dan said goodbye to his new friends. In 96, Sid and Susan phoned Dan. It appeared Sid was ready to sell the N72025. Stephen promptly arranged for a pre-purchase inspection. That was his friend. And an offer was made and accepted with two conditions. One, that Sid would deliver the aircraft to Maine, and two, that he would return at his leisure to fly it whenever he wanted to. Steve, assisted by the Portland FAA, acquired the necessary ferry permit that Sid would need for the flight to Maine, and it was a beautiful day when Sid touched down in Bethel in September of 97. As expected, Sid was practically in tears as he handed the keys over. Well, a great deal of maintenance was immediately put into the Luscombe so that Dan could prepare for a very important, very exciting first flight. Approximately 1 week after the delivery, on September 23rd, 1996, exactly 50 years to the day, that his grandfather Jerry had had his first flight in the Luscombe. Dan took to the skies. It was also Dan's first flight in the Luscombe. He'd been diligently preparing all week long, getting flight training to numerous conventional gear aircraft similar to the Luscombe. Dan flew the plane from the western mountains of Maine to Minot, where his grandfather first flew. The airport was still in operation, and the owner was still Roland Maher, who was now in his 80s and still flying. And as the morning fog dissipated, Dan touched down on the grass strip, and there awaited Gene and a special guest, along with Roland and Jerry's former associate, Roger, Dan's mother and father, Leo and Cecile Bilodeau, and other relatives were present. A few days before Steve had finished the maintenance on the plane, Jean had called Dan with exciting news. She had spoken with a man named Marcel Toutain, now in his 70s, who was the flight instructor that Jerry first flew with. He was the special guest that morning and had agreed to meet Dan and fly in the Luscombe. And therefore, as fate would have it, Dan and Marcel flew that morning in the same aircraft with the same pilot at the same airport as his grandfather did exactly 50 years prior. The flight began with a valuable lesson. Marcel explained with great caution how to safely handcraft the Luscombe. Marcel had turned out to be a wonderful instructor, and it was incredible that he could pick up where he had left off so many years ago. When they were ready for engine start, Dan shouted contact, and Roland, the man who owned the airport, hand-propped the Luscombe just as he did 50 years earlier when Jerry had purchased the plane. Once the operational checks were performed, N72025 departed, and when safely airborne, Marcel instinctively took the controls and began to fly. What lasted only 20 minutes seemed like a lifetime for Dan and Marcel, both exhibited to be there in the sky in their own way. And with a textbook three-point landing, all the hard work and preparation was over. And like that day in September 1946, Marcel signed Dan's pilot logbook, RFI, for registered flight instructor, just as he had done for the grandfather. The flight lesson was finished and a job well done. As of December 98, when this article was written, Steve, lives in Fredonia, Wisconsin, completing his training to become a new tribe's mission pilot. And Dan lives in Bryant Pond, Maine with his wife and is a DC-10 pilot for Continental Airlines. The old propeller now hangs in his home. And Jean, a terrific and loving grandmother, lives in Lewiston, Maine, as does Marcel and Roger, who both await rides with Dan. And Sid Mason visits his old airplane bi-yearly to fly it, as he did for many years. And Mahoyle Airport is still in business, operating in Minot. The Luscombe is hanging it there, its original home. And one last note, if anyone has a crown bottle cap manufactured between 1946 and 47 from Sunset Beverage Company with the words free ride, please contact Dan to arrange for your flight. There are a lot of pictures of various things up here, and there's a shot here of that plane, and we'll put it over there on the table.
We're going to give it to Mrs. Mason.
Okay. This came from Frank Ignachuk. Yes, it came off the internet, and this was the first time she's heard this story.
That's the first time I've heard
this. So,
is that right?
It's fitting that we give her the picture and the story.
Pictures of Maine, of the area up there on Summer Street. There's a picture, the first one over to the right, the biggest one is of the Mason family. There's many shots there. And then there's some shots from the air. And Paul has some of these town maps of that area up there. Do you folks have any questions that you want to ask any of these guys?
What was the biggest thing you ever saw fly over this town, Bert?
The Hindenburg. Does anybody remember seeing that fly over, man?
Yeah, I know, I did. She was old.
Yeah. I was sitting up on top of me and I heard this hum. And there of course the big swastika on the tail heading down over toward Boston. Bruce saw it over Worcester, came over there that way.
That was one of the many trips it made before.
It was the last trip.
It was the last trip. It was the last trip you saw.
It was the last trip.
Uh-huh. There's a question over here.
Well, just a statement. People have systems, you know, that have the Delarmy Street atlas on it. It turns out Sid is noticed on that. You can go to Sid's on the street address and find Sid's airport.
Do you want to say anything about the plan?
Well, does anybody ever remember there being a still in Maynard on Summer Street? Maybe moonshine?
Yes.
Anybody have anything on that? I heard it from my grandfather.
There was one up on the hill.
Well,
on the farm. Yeah, Herrick owned the farm.
Oh, Herrick owned the farm?
They owned that farm. Okay. My grandfather bought it from Cy Herrick.
Right, Cy was old.
And when he moved in there, he told me about the shares later. He said they were owned there for a short time, and Cy Herrick had legally could manufacture medicine. He had a still, but he was manufacturing a little bit extra medicine, I guess.
That's right.
Trucks would pull in with loads of sugar and then load up these big carboys and these big blue things on hell of a, I don't know, 4 or 5 gallons. Then load those up and go. And they tell me that they were watching them from Summer Hill for a long time. They backed in there one night and unloaded, and they started where they walked in. There was a still, and they found that the steam was coming out of the vent in the barn. That's the way they found it. They came in, they destroyed the still. My grandpa said that, well, they had only been there a short time, so when they went to court, they were exonerated. But, you know, I wonder. And there wasn't much money around then, you know, back after World War I. And I wonder if they were panning off at one time, as well as telling them to shut up or die, and that they're in the new part, we said. I was wondering that maybe that helped pay for the bomb, too. I don't know that. I don't know that, but I suspect, you know, because he was kind of tight-lipped. He just told me about it, you know, incidentally.
What was he, a taster?
Huh?
He was a taster?
No, he had friends up there. We had a big apple orchard across the street that Cy Herrick put in back years ago, and the cows would get into it, you know, and if they'd eat apples, they would ferment in their stomach and make alcohol. They wouldn't milk. They wouldn't. Getting milk, so we had to pick up the apples, take up the cider mill. He had 3 or 4 barrels of hard cider of his own formula that he left outside in the wintertime. And they pulled some kind of white liquid out of it for growers. And he used to sit around, all his old friends had come up from Maine, and they'd sit around the coffee table and pour all of this stuff in. It looked like cream. It made the coffee turn white. So I don't know. But, you know, as it goes, I never let the truth interfere with a good story.
So who saw the still? They were up on the Summer Hill and they saw the
They were up on Summer Hill. They saw the steam. Well, they've been watching for quite a while. They knew that Cy Herrick had, he had legally a permit to make medicine. But he was making, you know, and I think that's probably why he got out of there before they nailed him, too. Yeah.
In the watchtower?
No, there was nothing there. There was no trees or nothing on that hill. No, they were just sitting up there on the stone
wall. So who was there?
The feds? Oh, no, it was the feds. You know, they were, at that time, they were chasing all the moonshiners.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was, that must have been, well, that was after World War One sometime, because they, when they came from Finland, they came to Quincy, and I've got an uncle buried in Quincy. And then they came to Maine to work in the mill, and they lived down on Harrison Street for a while. And then he decided he wanted, he was a veterinarian by trade in the old country. So he decided he wanted to be a, go back to the farm, and he did. They had, we were milking 50 or 60 head of cattle. Shovel it in one end and out the other. And if you, cows don't give milk, you have to take it.
So how far back did your, the barn go back? Is it
well, barn,
consistent
yeah,
of the streets
well,
now?
Well, if you look at these maps, it went back as far as Rockland Avenue. You know, way back. And,
we had about 30 acres in
stock.
Yeah.
It's extended
to
the Mason Farm. We had across the street and up around. If you look at the map, there was quite a bit of property that went with the farm. They were all cow pastures. We had several people that raised the devil on the farm. I wouldn't mention any names, but I'm kind of ugly, that guy, you know. Oh, what a cop. Yeah, that's the guy. Yeah, he was one of those guys that hung around. Bad guy. They used to swing from the trees and onto the back of the cows and ride them. I was born at home, and when my mother saw me, she was taken to the hospital. Then my brother was born on Christmas Day several years later, and they tell me that I pulled the Christmas tree down and trampled on it. Well, if you knew my brother got him for Christmas, you'd do the same thing. We were always up at the Mason Farm. We had to run up there. We used to fly out of there. We had a horseshoe pit. I don't know how many people. There must have been 20 or 30 guys up there all the time pitching horseshoes on Sundays and drinking not beer, of course. We wouldn't drink beer, only by the bathtub full.
So that there was the Mason Farm and the top
side
of the farm.
By side, yeah.
And then coming down to the main, what?
Well, there was the piggery was way back. That road, the first road on St. Ed Street. First street on... What's that street where the piggery road was? I forget what that street was. What's that street?
Dix Road.
Yeah, that's the road that went down to the piggery. It's not Dix Road, it's Piggery Road still.
Dix Road is still there.
Yeah.
It goes to this still.
Yeah.
So the piggery was way in front of that.
Yeah. But we went right, we had...
Well, I had a big curve.
There's a big curve.
It went down, what?
There's a lot of property in there.
Because the figure is right at the end of the
Yeah, it was right on the corner there. And I remember when it wasn't. The figure was still there, and Cheryl Jones decided to put in pumpkins, and he leased the field, and he put in a field. I never saw so many pumpkins. It was the pig manure for fertilizer. I never saw so many tin cans in my life. But there were pumpkins. We went down to help load pumpkins. Do you remember those pumpkins, Wally Gosh? What a pile. There are millions of them, it seems. I think they took them into Boston, to the market, but some places they made pies.
I remember your grandfather used to go around peddling vegetables to the,
yeah,
to the,
back of
the Finnish ladies in town, and then he'd ask him, how's this cauliflower? And he'd say, I don't know, I never tasted it in my life.
Oh, no. My grandfather was a meat and potato fan. That's all they ate. Cauliflower, no cabbage, no nothing.
Green beans.
Thank you. Green beans. When I was a kid, I used to hang around your father's and grandfather's farm.
Yeah.
On the hottest days, we'd be out in the field, and 2 o'clock, let's go into the kitchen.
Yeah, coffee. Hot
coffee.
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 Hey,
coffee. 2 o'clock on the hottest days.
That's the truth. Yeah. Coffee pot was always on.
When you lived there, who owned the picnic?
Cheryl Jones. He lived on Tremont Street.
When they sold the Kennedy.
Kennedy stripped all the loom.
And there's a picture of it up in here. You'll see where the farm is all stripped. There's a big puddle in it. They took out three, four, five feet of lawn, and most of that is down on 128. They used it down there. Kennedy stripped it, and before they could stop him, he had to strip the whole thing.
Well, you used to have some pretty good peat fires going.
Oh, yeah, there was a lot of peat down
there.
The
ground would never freeze.
Yeah, yeah, it kept us warm in the winter.
Who started those, Rick?
I didn't do it. I was on myself. I think it was you.
Thanks, Jim. Now you're good.
So you got, I don't know. Yeah, it was
before that.
Yeah,
yeah. Early '50s.
Because we sold the farm to the Nilgus family.
How long did they run? That's Wally's family.
Yeah, yeah. When did they sell that to? Do you remember now? But it was 1946 when we sold to the Nilgus, because he said that the world was going to stop and he wanted to be on the farm.
I always thought they were a crazy family. Boy, they were crazy.
No, well, they married some crazy people.
That's good. They were all right.
Well, he now lives in the oldest house in existence in Maine.
Yeah, I live in the oldest house in Maine. Got my mother owns it. Oldest house in Maine. It's the only one that's left. What was the date on that? 200-some-odd years? 230 years old, is it? 1764, yeah, something like that. It should have been burned down in 1765. Roy remembers the farm. He was up there many times. He always tinkled there with always your mother and father. That was quite a group, wasn't it?
1764.
Oh. When did they pave Summer Street? Before my time, all I remember is the WPA digging it up to put water and sewer in when I was a kid. Then I was walking to school one day, and the strangest thing I ever saw, to this day, I was walking down the stone wall that they had built, and there was a snake there, and I jumped over because I was running, and it was rattling. It was a rattlesnake. And I never knew we had rattlesnakes. Wow. We had, it was a rattlesnake. I looked at that thing, and I just took off. That was it. Strange.
Any more questions?
Oh, did you find on the Indian areas or anything?
Oh, yeah, there was a spy place there when they were building that wall. They were cutting it. You remember that? Well, you remember that when they found that fireplace on your land. It was on your father's land, about halfway down.
I'm not sure whether it was my land now or.
Right across, no, it was right there, right across.
Arenas.
No, right across, yeah, where Arenas is. Yeah, where it was
right
your father's land. Yeah, about where Arena's house is right now.
Yeah.
They were digging, they found this fireplace and arrowheads in it, so that stopped that project for a while they came out from, I don't know where they came out.
WPA.
Huh? Yeah, WPA did that, yeah.
Because of Waller. When they built the wall.
So did Harvard
University
get the arrowheads, or where did they go?
I don't know where they went. They had a bunch of...
What happened is they were so far from the project that a lot of the stones and stuff had already destroyed. Some of the landowners around there.
Yeah, I didn't get any. They wouldn't let me near it. Well, they got them all, they won't give me one.
On your farm, Rick, is there a cave on the hill?
I don't remember that.
You know, there's a spot there.
Yeah, I don't remember that.
That's on the main at Great Old Side, it's the old Smith farm.
Yeah?
On Smith farm.
Yeah.
Yeah, but in back of Littlefield's house, which built across from you guys, there used to be somewhat of a cave. And I don't know.
A lot of rocks up on the hill,
yeah,
I know.
Right.
Yeah, I remember when I was on the farm, the old water pipe first coming down from it.
Wow.
It flooded the field and everything. Yeah, coming across the road.
Well, we never had a brook coming down into the farm until they put the reservoir in. It leaked so bad it created its own
Yep.
And that's what fed the cows.
Yep.
Come down, piped into that, put the cows trot in there, and always served the water. Didn't matter if there was a drought.
No, we always
had water. They were pumping into the reservoir. That's good.
Now, if I give you some answers, can you put questions to them so it make it easier? Well, that doesn't work.
Okay, well,
He's going to be around, so if you've got questions, go talk to him. The displays are here, the refreshments are over there, Paul's over there with his stuff. And the next meeting is the fourth Monday in January, and we're going to have a program on Maynard Post Office. David Griffin, who's running the machine over here, is coordinating this program with some staff from down there. They wanted to do something on where the post offices were in Maynard through all the years, etc. So that should be very interesting. You'll receive a newsletter by that time, so. Okay.
Time.